Hello and welcome to another episode of Full Court Finance here at Zach's. I'm your host, Ben Rains. And today we're talking about some more Nike news. We talked Nike last week on the podcast, but some relatively big news came out late last week. And they're also going to do some quick live streaming sports updates to round up the show, because also some news came out late last week. And this is why we record on Monday mornings, because we get to talk about that news to start the week. But before we get into any of that, I want to say, remember, if you have any questions or episode suggestions, please feel free to shoot us an email over at podcast@zacks.com. So late last week on Friday, Major League Baseball and Nike announced a 10-year deal that will see the sportswear giant become the official uniform and footwear supplier of Major League Baseball starting in the 2020 season. And there had been some rumors that Nike was going to take over this Major League Baseball deal, even though Under Armour had signed pretty much the exact same deal back in 2016. And then over the course of the next couple of years, there was rumors floating around that Under Armour was going to back out of the deal as they kind of changed their what has been said is changed their marketing strategy. I think there might be some different reasons, but we won't really get into that today. So basically, Nike will design the apparel that the players are wearing on the field. So jerseys, anything they're wearing underneath, warm-ups, hats, all that stuff. And then actually, sorry, hats definitely aren't included. Nike will not be making those. But besides that, Fanatics will be making all of the fan-based gear, so any jerseys that they're selling to fans, so anything the players are not actually wearing themselves, Fanatics will make that. And that's what Under Armour is going to do as well. So Fanatics is this e-commerce-based sportswear company that sells fan team gear. We'll talk about them a little bit more in a second. So the question is, why really does this matter on a big scale? Well, first of all, it's interesting that Under Armour is backing out, because at one point in 2016, they're signing this deal. They're going to be the official sponsor of Major League Baseball, the first big league they're going to be the official sponsor of. Nike and Adidas might be feeling a little bit of pressure for Under Armour. They're coming up in a big way. Everyone's talking about them. Steph Curry is now on the rise at that point, and it seems like, oh man, maybe Under Armour's really going to be that legitimate third player with Nike and Adidas. Since then, it doesn't really seem like that will be the case, at least not anytime soon. So Nike's now taken over their sportswear domination. They now have the NFL. They signed a 10-year extension last spring with the NFL, so they're the official sponsor of the biggest sport in America still, by far, the NFL. They're also the official sponsor of the NBA. They signed an 8-year deal that started in the 2017-2018 season that's worth roughly $1 billion with the NBA. And the NBA, as I've talked about on the show before, is a quickly growing sport, especially in the rest of the world, in Europe, and then also hugely, hugely popular in China, which is a great market for Nike and the NBA in general. So as I said, now, at this point, Nike has Major League Baseball, the NBA, the NFL, the three most popular professional sports leagues in North America. They have a huge global soccer presence, where they're on a team-by-team basis. So they're not officially sponsoring any leagues or anything like that, but they get individual teams deals where they're taking on Adidas in that field. So Nike is really, once again, proving that they're trying to expand into as many areas as possible while also growing their sportswear-based business, which is that more casual athleisure wear that Lululemon has done really well in selling, and why they've grown so quickly and become such a hugely popular publicly traded company. And now I want to quickly talk just about Fanatics for those of you who have not heard about them, because they're now part of the NFL's deal with Nike, and they're a part of this Major League Baseball deal with Nike, where the Fanatics is making all of in selling all of the fan-based gear. So they're an e-commerce-based company. They pretty much sell college, pro sports, international sports, any gear fans would ever wear to a game or anything like that. They're selling that. The owner, Michael Rubin, has actually grown relatively popular. He is now a part of the ownership group of the 76ers, the NBA team. And interestingly enough, he's become kind of relevant in popular culture because him and the president or the owner of the New England Patriots, Robert Kraft, have kind of joined up with Meek Mill, this rapper, and are really they're going on CNN in the last couple of weeks and talking about pushing for prison reform. So this guy's now tied to kind of the popular culture aspect of the sports world as well. And back in 2011, he sold his old company, which was online e-commerce companies, a multitude of them. He sold them to eBay for $2.4 billion in 2011, and then he bought back the company that would later become Fanatics from eBay. So good for him. He had some foresight there. And then why Nike and the NFL and Major League Baseball are deciding to partner with Fanatics is because they really want to be a part of this instant gratification trend, and where, say, a consumer is or a fan is watching the game. And this is, the NFL said this like pretty much word for word. They're partnering with Fanatics and Nike because they want to be able to say someone's watching a game on Sunday, some random player they never heard of who might have been like a 6th round pick scores a touchdown. Hey, I want to buy this guy's jersey today on my phone. And Nike doesn't necessarily have the business at this point to quickly start selling that guy's jersey like day of, ship it out to people, where that's like Fanatics' whole business. And that's why they're partnering with Nike and the NFL and Major League Baseball. So definitely is a company to pay attention to going forward. They're growing pretty quickly. I've listened to some interviews with Michael Rubin, and 10 years ago he was basically saying that Amazon and Alibaba are going to take over commerce. We can't necessarily compete with them on this big scale, so we're going to go really specific and only do sports-based gear. So that's the story with Major League Baseball and Nike and then this Fanatics. And then late last week, Morgan Stanley came out, not necessarily anything to do with this Nike Major League Baseball deal, but they came out and they upgraded Nike stock while also simultaneously lowering Adidas. And this is, as I said, Morgan Stanley. So Morgan Stanley analyst Lauren Castle has an overweight rating on Nike and a $103 price target. And she is saying that she believes the market is underestimating the cyclical business of Adidas at this point, which had been really strong for the last couple of years. But she believes they could face some top-line pressure, and then I'm going to now quote from her note to clients. We believe Adidas' recent slowdown has been directly linked in part to Nike's aggressive comeback and impressive innovation pipeline, with some market share shifting back to Nike, particularly in Western Europe, the U.S., and China. And this is from her note to clients last Thursday. And then she talks specifically about their direct-to-consumer business. And then I want to quickly mention just how important Nike's direct-to-consumer business is. So Nike's digital revenues last quarter surged 41%. In mobile ordering, mobile business is now accounting for well over 50% of their digital commerce revenue. So you can see why all these companies are really paying attention to places where people are buying stuff directly from their phone. And CFO Andy Champion has said that the digital part of Nike's business will eventually, by 2023, so the next 4 years, it's going to be a 30% of the company's overall business, up from 15% right now. So digital is where Nike's growing. It's where Adidas is trying to grow. It's where Under Armour is trying to grow, where all these companies are trying to grow. And then, as I mentioned, Morgan Stanley downgraded Adidas to underweight at the same time. So those were some quick notes at the end about Adidas and Nike. And now I want to transition a little bit stumbly on to a totally separate topic, but it's one of these trends we talk about a lot. And there was some streaming TV news that came out last week. So we had Google, YouTube TV, it's basically you can watch 40 or so of the channels you'd have on your cable package streaming on YouTube TV, and they're officially expanding what they call nationwide. It's a $40 a month service. It's soon going to be available in 95 new U.S. markets, which they say will bring it up to 195 regions, which accounts for 98% of U.S. households. And this was according to their blog post late last week. And as I mentioned, YouTube TV is pretty much a live streaming of a slimmed down version of most people's cable packages. So you can get Fox and ABC and CNN and ESPN and all these things. And then you can add on, just like your cable package, you could add on HBO or Stars. And you even have the ability to record programming and things like that. So these services like YouTube TV are really the way that people who still want to have some aspect of watching live TV, especially sports, can really get to be a part of this cord-cutting business. Because you can't, if you like to watch sports, you can't necessarily just get rid of your cable package and only have Netflix, because Netflix doesn't have anything live. So you're still going to have to then try to find some janky website where they're, you're going to have to steal the stream of the game, and it's not necessarily the best coverage. So services like YouTube TV are allowing you to be a sports fan and watch all these live games with pretty great streams of all these games. Really, I've watched YouTube TV and Hulu TV at friends' houses. I still have cable package myself, but you really can't tell the difference besides the interface. And as I said, one of YouTube's big pitches for their YouTube live TV is basically saying you can still watch sports. Consumers can watch the big game. When they put out this little release last week, they were talking about, like, you can sign up and you can still watch the big game because the Super Bowl is coming up next, or this upcoming Sunday. So that's a big draw for people. People want to be able to watch these live sports. And as I've said now countless times, live sports is going to be one of the only real things that is going to be able to attract advertisers and marketers in the long run, because everything else is completely on demand. Netflix, Amazon Prime, HBO, those are the companies and the platforms that people are turning to, and those don't have advertisements. So where are the advertisers going to go besides Facebook and Google? And then live sports is pretty much what's going on there. So YouTube haven't disclosed that many of their actual numbers, but the service reportedly increased from 300,000 paying subscribers in January 2018 to this past summer. They were almost up to 1 million. So those aren't necessarily the most up-to-date numbers, but those are the most up-to-date numbers I could find, because Google has not officially released these numbers. So it's still a pretty small service, but it's important to know that they're expanding as Disney's ready to roll out, Apple's ready to roll out their own streaming platform, AT&T is going to roll out their own streaming platform all within the next year or so. And this is really, as we've talked about before, the future of entertainment is all going to be kind of on the streaming end. And it'll be really interesting because there are so many different companies that are offering their own version of this, that eventually you're going to have to decide out of these 10 providers. You can't just, if you're all of a sudden paying for 10 of these, that's going to get really expensive. And then all of a sudden you're thinking, maybe my cable bill was actually not that bad before, when I'm paying for Hulu and Netflix and Amazon Prime and HBO and Disney and Apple, AT&T and all these different services. So it'll be really interesting to watch how that happens in the next year or so. And then a quick little note at the end is that Hulu last week, after Netflix raised all their prices right before they announced their earnings, Hulu is now lowering their price of their basic plan from $7.99 a month to $5.99 a month. And that is not their big plan. That I think this is their ad supported plan a little bit. So some ads run during that. And this is not their Hulu live TV or anything, but they're lowering the price of their most basic plan to encourage more people to sign up. Everything else is actually the Hulu live TV service, which is similar to the YouTube live TV, is actually going to be costing now users $5 more. So at the same time, they're lowering the price of their basic plan. They're raising the price of that new plan that they're really trying to attract people with, which is access to that live TV as well. And as I said, at the same time, Netflix raised their prices. So they're really maybe hoping that people who are more budget conscious will think, hey, why not go to this one service that's now only $6 a month when Netflix is raising the prices of all of their packages, including their most basic package. And Hulu is definitely a company to pay a little bit closer attention to as well, because at this point, their ownership is going to be coming a little bit up in the air at basically at this point. So Disney is going to be the majority owner as soon as their Fox deal with 21st Century Fox officially closes. Fox has a 30% stake and Disney has a 30% stake. So they'll now have a 30% stake. And Comcast is the other company that has a 30% stake. And then Warner Media holds 10%. So at this point then, with Disney becoming the official majority owner with 60%, there's been a lot of rumors and reports about companies like Comcast or Warner Media maybe selling their portion of Hulu to Disney, or maybe Disney getting rid of their majority and just spinning off Hulu. Who knows at this point? So it'll definitely be worth keeping your eye on what happens with Hulu in the next year or so as this streaming market and industry just continues to grow really at an insane pace. But until next time, I'm your host, Ben Rains. And remember, if you have any questions, please feel free to shoot us an email over at podcast@zacks.com.